Hi, Andrew with Evermore Studio here. I have been playing with a workflow to take some of my Celtic knots from a pencil sketch to a 3D model to a depth map to physical carvings on a laser engraver or a desktop CNC, and I thought I would make a video to share that. This is kind of an intermediate level tutorial. I will try to spell things out so that it is possible to follow along like a recipe, but I am not going to try to cover the basics of using Inkscape, Nomad Sculpt, Blender, or the control software for the machines. That would be too much, and there are other videos that cover those things. I'll try to list some of those in the description. If you have suggestions for basic tutorials for those programs, please let us know in the comments. I started out making a rough pencil sketch of the knot, then repeated the construction process in Inkscape. One common technique for designing knots is to use a grid of squares with a dot in the middle of each, or a diagonal grid, depending on how you want to look at it. Add some lines as barriers and thread the knot into the spaces between the dots. As with almost anything this size, I'm sure this is not an original knot design, but it's good for showing off the process. In Inkscape, I just made a single unified path, then used the knot path effect to do the under and over weaving. I exported the knot as a simple PNG and put it where I could import it into Nomad Sculpt on my iPad. In Nomad Sculpt on the iPad, I start a new project, delete the default sphere, and add a cube. I will up the divisions on the cube to something around 64. Now we move to a top view and set the PNG version of our knot as the reference image. I try to get the view of the cube as large as I can and still see it all on the screen. You can adjust the size and transparency of the reference image as well as the degree to which it overlays our cube. You can also pan the view to get the reference image aligned with the center of the top face of the cube. This isn't really critical, we just don't want the knot hanging off the edge of the cube. Under the camera icon, I'm going to add a view so that we can come back to this instantly at any time if we move away accidentally or intentionally. Also note here that I am working entirely in orthographic view rather than perspective. With our base and reference set up, it is time to rough out our knot with the tube tool. We will set the tube tool to curve. You can adjust the smoothing and lazy rope stabilizer settings to help you get a smoother initial pass at the knot. These settings are mostly a matter of taste for how steady your hand is. Next, I will trace my knot, trying to stay about in the center of the fat lines. It's okay if this is a bit rough, we are going to smooth it out and clean it up as we go. After I get back to the starting point and lift my pencil, I get the initial rough version of my tube. Clicking on the closed icon in the tube toolbar joins the ends. Now we can start cleaning up the knot. Drag the control points to move them. Dragging a point on top of another point will cause those two points to merge. Tapping on the line will add a point. This is an exercise in placing the control points into a general symmetry. You'll want a control point at every spot the line will go on top of the crossing section. You will frequently also want points immediately to each side of that one to help control how steeply the path goes back down. This is particularly important where a path crosses over, then below in a short space. Once it is looking about like I want, I move to a front view and hide the reference image. I am going to hide the base block for the moment too. Optionally, use the gizmo control to flatten the tube a little bit. This is just about how you want the finished knot to look. Duplicate the tube to help figure out positioning of the parts of the knot that will cross on top. Use the gizmo to stack this duplicate tube right on top of the other. This doesn't have to be absolutely exact, just visually aligned. Next, bring back the base box and duplicate it. Use the gizmo to drag it directly up. Align the bottom of the top of the box with the middle of the duplicate tube. We don't need the duplicate tube anymore, so hide or delete it. Special thanks to Holger Schoenischke for helping me work out the neat technique for this next bit. If you're interested in 3D modeling with Nomad Sculpt, check out his videos. He has a constant stream of clever new techniques. Link in the description, of course. With the top box as the active object, still in the front view, use the Select Mask tool with the rectangle setting to select a tiny bit of the bottom of the top box. Use the mask tools to extract a very thin shell. In theory, this could be a zero thickness shell, but it works more consistently for me with some minimal thickness. This will create a new piece of mesh. We can hide or delete the top box now. We need to be able to see through the new piece, change the material to additive, and lower the opacity a bit. Back in the top view, we are going to make our tube the active object, and we are going to lock that object so that we can work on the tube through the top plate mesh. If you don't have the lock control in your lower toolbar, you can turn it on in the interface settings. Back to editing our tube with the tube tool. Make sure snap is turned on. Now, when you move a point, it will automatically snap to the upper plate. We can proceed with weaving our knot. If you make a mistake and notice it immediately, you can use undo. You can use the yellow control point to adjust the width of the tube to make a heavier or finer knot. If you want to adjust the lower points, just hide the top plate, and the tube control points will stick to the base box again and stay on the lower level. Moving the points around, you can get some less stiff transitions for the crossovers. Optionally, you can use the spline setting to get smoother curves. The last step is to add some extra subdivision for a smoother finish and validate the tube. I generally do this with a copy, hiding the backup tube, in case I find something I want to come back and change. We want to minimize the number of extraneous objects we have to deal with when we move to Blender. I might want to come back and do more editing or do something else with this knot, so I usually save a copy of the project before deleting all the construction and backup objects. Export the simplified knot to a GLTF 2.0 file, saving it somewhere we can open it in Blender. A depth map is a grayscale representation of a 3D object where the closest parts of the model are at one end of the range and the farthest parts are at the other end. Typically, the closest parts are white and the farthest parts are black, with everything in between an appropriate shade of gray. We are going to use the free open source modeling tool Blender to turn our 3D knot into a depth map. Starting with a new scene in Blender, I delete the default cube and import the 3D knot model we created in Nomad Sculpt. For general convenience, I set the knot object to 5 units square with the properties slide out and land it on the zero plane right in the center of the scene by using G and Z while in a direct side view. The camera goes in the middle of the scene, pointing straight down. Switch the camera to an orthographic perspective and move it just above the knot. We don't need a light for our purposes, so let's delete that to keep it out of the way. We want to use the Cycles rendering engine. A little lower in the Scene tab, I'm going to check Transparent in case I want to make the background of the final image transparent later. In the Scene Format tab, we're going to set the output to be a 2000 pixel square. Setting the color depth to 16 bits may not be necessary, but it won't hurt. In the View Layer tab, we want to make sure both Combined and Z are checked. You won't have depth connectors later in the Compositing tab if you miss this. Use the camera view and, in the camera tab, adjust the orthographic scale to mostly fill the frame with the knot. Since there is no light in the scene, if we do a normal render now, we will just get a noisy gray shadow. I'll take a moment to scale the output window to keep it in view. Now we are going to switch to the compositing workspace and check the Use Nodes box. I will use the search to add Normalize, Invert, Gamma, and Viewer Nodes. Depth from the render layer goes to the value input on the Normalize node. The value output goes to the color input on the Invert node so that we get white for close and black for far. The color output of the Invert goes to the color on the Gamma node. The Gamma's image output goes to the image input of the Viewer node. At this point, you should see the image in the background of the workspace. We can fit it to the available area to see the whole image. Now we can adjust the factor of the Gamma node to get a good range from the white to dark gray on our knot. Something in the range of 1.6 to 1.9 seems to be about right for the knots I have been making. You could also use an RGB curves node in place of the Gamma to adjust this. Switch to our render output window and choose the viewer node from the center dropdown. Now we can save the image to a PNG. If you want a transparent background in your final image, you can connect the alpha output from the render layers node to the alpha input on the viewer node before saving the PNG. Time for a quick side trip. One thing 3D depth maps are used for is creating single image stereograms, sometimes called magic eye images. These are images made of noisy, repeating patterns that displace bits of the pattern in a way that create the illusion of three dimensions when the viewer forces their vision to go wall-eyed, as if staring through the plane of the image. There's all kinds of software for making those, including several web-based options. Here I feed our new depth map to one and use a stylized hammered copper tile I created as the pattern image. I'm not sure how useful this really is as a visualization tool, but it's fun and easy now that we have a good depth map. There will be a link to the stereogram image in the description if you want to go stare at it. A laser engraver can use a depth map to make a 3D carving. After a little experimentation, I got a pretty good 3D carving on quarter-inch thick base wood with my Glowforge. I did this in four passes, using the settings to vary the laser power with the white at the lowest and the black at the highest power. These are essentially the settings Jonathan at Maker Tales worked out for the Glowforge. I'll link to his video in the description. This approach is similar to what you would do with traditional machining, with a couple roughing passes, then a couple passes at higher resolutions and lower power to bring out the details. The result is pretty heavily charred. I was able to remove a fair amount of the char with some water and a toothbrush. I tried some other things, like isopropyl alcohol, but always got some pretty serious curling of the wood at the slightest touch of moisture. I let the piece dry on a flat surface under a couple of heavy garden pavers, which got it back to flat. It turns out that my long-neglected Nomad 883 desktop CNC machine can also create a 3D carving from a depth map run through Meshcam. Thanks to Brandon and the team at Carbide 3D for helping me get the machine back up and running. I cut this knot in the same base wood in multiple passes with three different end mills, a number 102 flat, a 101 ball, and a smaller 111 ball. I probably could have managed a nicer finish by doing more work with the smaller cutter. Still, this seems pretty decent. Thank you. Comparing the laser carved version with the CNC carved version, each has its virtues and flaws. There are enough variables in technique, materials, and equipment that I don't know that any abstract lessons in comparison here are particularly useful. For what I have been doing, both approaches would likely need some additional finishing to really look polished. The CNC carved piece might have a better shot at getting there with some careful sanding. The texturing from the laser is comparatively deep and might not sand well. After sanding, the CNC piece would need some treatment, maybe a stain, to really make it pop. While the laser gets finer detail without the extra effort of switching end mills, the CNC was quite a bit faster, about 40 minutes versus 2 hours. Of course, you could also feed this model to a 3D printer. I hope you found this interesting and useful. I am really excited to have figured out how to make 3D knotwork models and to have filled all the gaps for this workflow chain. If you have a suggestion or if you do something with this, please share it in the comments here or on the Evermore Studio site. Thanks for watching.